And next, I would like to bring up the SherlockNet team to tell us a bit about their work. They applied some, you know, I'd say, let's call them modern machine learning techniques to automatically tag and to some extent caption the digital images in our collection. And this category of technology has really come along tremendously in the last, you know, 5 to 10 years. And I think, you know, this is an important step. And the role that this sort of tagging and captioning will play in providing not only researchers, but everybody with the ability to understand, find, at a very fine grain, things like digital images within our collections will be remarkable. And I wonder, we didn't ask this question to Melissa earlier, but you know, I wonder if the fixation that we have on text is partly because of how incredibly difficult it is to find images or non-textual items in collections where they appear. So, if we please welcome, will you all come up together or one at a time? So, welcome the SherlockNet team and to present the photos. Thanks so much, and I will.
Hello, everybody. We are SherlockNet, and our project is called Tagging and Captioning the British Library 1 Million Image Dataset. And I'd like to take a moment to thank the British Library for hosting us here today. It's been wonderful so far. My name is Karen. I did my bachelor's in computer science at Stanford, and I'm currently continuing with the master's degree.
Hi, I'm Brian. I also did my bachelor's at Stanford in computer science, and I'm doing a medical degree and PhD at Harvard right now.
I'm Luda, also a undergrad and now current master's student at the Department of Computer Science at Stanford. Really excited to be here.
So the data set we use for this project, as Melissa talked about before, is the British Library Flickr Commons collection. It has over 1 million images on topics ranging from travel to anthropology to science. And the British Library initially uploaded it for the general public and for researchers to use in new and interesting ways. However, the initial tags that were uploaded were not super useful. They gave information about the page number, the volume, the date that the volume was published. However, for someone who might be looking for a specific topic or subject, they didn't have tags that actually described the image or the category that the image belonged to. So, for example, with this image of an ancient temple ruins, we imagine that someone who's interested in this type of image might be looking for keywords such as building, architecture, temple, etc. And this implies more sophisticated tagging techniques are needed. Luckily, in the past couple of years, computer vision has been getting better and better due to research in neural networks. So neural networks are a computer vision technology that's been used for image recognition very successfully in the past couple of years, sometimes even outperforming humans in image recognition tasks. So our project was focused on using neural networks to generate descriptive tags for all 1 million images in the British Library collection. So today we're gonna talk briefly about what neural networks are. Then we're gonna talk about our first pass to the data set, categorizing every single image into one of 12 categories. Then we're going to talk about how we used OCR data to generate lots of other tags besides categories. We'll talk about image captioning, and finally, we'll present our web interface for accessing all of this data. So for our project, we use neural networks in every aspect, from classifying images to finding related images, and also for generating captions. And neural networks just happen to be really good at all these tasks. We'll talk a little bit about why that is and how they work at a high level. So consider the problem of classifying inputs into categories. So here we have an image, and we have the categories of cat, dog, hat, or mug. So for a human, it might be straightforward. It's a little bit harder for a computer. At a high level, what a neural network does is it takes an input and it computes a score for each category. So the higher the score, the more likely that input is of that category. So in this case, we have that it's most likely to be a cat, which seems pretty reasonable. So how a neural network works is the input is passed through multiple layers in the process of computing a score. And each layer has these things called neurons, which are sort of activated by certain features of an image. So you could have a neuron that detects cat ears. You could have another neuron that detects like cat tails, that sort of stuff. So it's the concept of a neuron is similar to the concept of biological neurons in our brains and spinal cords. Although the analogy is not perfect, our biological neurons are much more complex. But in the case of a neural network, the multiple layers, so the input, the hidden, the output, for example, is what allows it to build such complex models. And in general, the more neurons you have, so the more circles you have, the better results you get. And in particular, convolutional neural networks, or CNNs for short, it sounds kind of scary, but it's just a flavor of neural networks, and they are optimized for images in particular. So next, Brian will talk a little bit more about how we use CNNs to categorize images into tags.
Hi, Brian again. Thanks, Karen. And I hope our American accents aren't too hard on the ears. All right, so I want to talk a bit about our tagging. And again, we wanted to tag all million images in the British Library data set. To do this, we used convolutional neural networks, which is what Karen talked about. In particular, we used, I'll flip over to the next slide, we used a Google-built neural network, which had already been pre-trained by Google to classify images. But we rebuilt parts of the neural network specifically for this purpose. What we did was we manually annotated 10,000 images into one of 12 categories. And these categories, again, include things like maps, decorations, people. We worked with Agent Edwards of the British Library. Not sure if he's here, but if he is, hello, to get these categories. As our output, so it goes, the image like goes through the neural network, and its output is what you see on the right-hand side. For each of the 12 categories, you'll get a confidence score, and we take the highest one. So this one's obviously more likely to be a person than architecture. We did this for all million images, and so on the left, you'll see a distribution of how many images in the data set belong to each category. You can see that people, like there are about 200,000 people in the data set, and that makes sense because a lot of books are just full of portraits of people. But there are also a lot of images of nature, of architecture, of decorations, et cetera. And so it's really interesting that the distribution is actually pretty even, which makes it a really good tool for future research. What we were pretty excited about was how good the model was, just sort of based on limited tuning. Top one accuracy refers to ability of the neural network to classify into the category that we annotated manually. And so it did that 81% of the time, which is really good. But what was more interesting was the top three accuracy, which is within the computer's top three predictions, is our annotation in that top three. And it did that 97% of the time, which is really good. And so we thought, we'll show you some of those examples. This is the screenshots of the interface that Karen's going to show later on. But right now, we'll just use screenshots of them. So these are things we classified as organisms, people, and animals. And you can see a lot of people and animals, which is great. Then we'll look for maps. 15 of 20 of these are maps. A lot of are the ones that aren't maps look kind of like maps because they're complex. So like, oh, mouse doesn't work, it's fine. Yeah, and architecture, so all of these are buildings. And what's really interesting is that, well, almost all of them are buildings, but the really interesting thing is that it's able to detect lots of different kinds of buildings, not just like one canonical building type. And that illustrates the power of a convolutional neural network, is that it sort of learns what architecture is and is able to extrapolate to things that don't necessarily look like the things that it learned. So we think that's a really powerful tool. Okay, so then advanced tagging. We thought about, okay, well, we have like one tag for every image now, but as Melissa has talked about and how Hannah has talked about, you kind of want more detail in the images that you're looking at. And so we looked at different strategies, and one strategy that we came up with, it's interesting, Melissa talked about this also, like kind of highlights conversion evolution of ideas, was to use optical character recognition, the surrounding text around the image, you've heard this before, surrounding text around the images in order to get good tags. And this is sort of the Google Images approach. If you look for a cat in Google Images, what it'll do is it'll look for all web pages that have the word cat on them, and then it'll give you all the pictures on those images that it thinks are cats. And so we thought, okay, we'll just do this. And what we did was we took the OCR, so this example is a tree sparrow. We took all the words on the image, on this page, and filtered for noun phrases, and these are sort of the noun phrases that you get. And what we noticed was that a lot of words are relevant. Bird, species, coloring, but a lot of words are not. Person, number, writers. And so we were trying to think of ways to filters so that we would only have the relevant tags. And what we came up with was a strategy called voting. The idea is that for every image, we'll find in our data set 20 of the most similar images. And I'll talk about how we do that in a sec. After that, we'll take all the words surrounding all of those images, and we'll have the images vote on which words are the most likely or the most common. And the idea is that that should give you the tags that best describe the original image. So I'll explain each of those steps in more detail. The first step is to find related images. The way we do this is, again, through our neural network. Our neural network computes, so you can see a tree sparrow, and then it goes through a neural network, and it comes out, what comes out, or at least in one of the intermediate steps, is a vector or a set of numbers which describes some sort of abstract representation of the image. And we don't really know what those abstract features are, but they could be like, okay, three is maybe like the presence of a bird, and then maybe another one is like how dark the image is, and then another one's maybe, I don't know, like how big the stomach of the bird is. So we don't really know. But the idea is that if you calculate this this vector for every single image in the data set, you can calculate the distance between this original vector and all the other vectors and find the images that are most similar. So here, the two birds have vectors that are much more similar to our original vector than all the other images. So we have related images. And so now we take the surrounding text from all these images. One of the challenges, as Hannah talked a lot about, was OCR. Like, it's not perfect. We were lucky that the British Library had done OCR in 2007 or 08, but there's a lot of spelling errors and also the problem of stemming, where words have a lot of suffixes, like great, you can have like greatly, greatness. How do you put it back into the stem? So we developed and used natural language tools that do both of those. So if I flip back and forth, you can get rid of the stems. And we also did spell check using Levenshtein distance and some other things that we sort of built and used from APIs. So then, now that we have a cleaned up set, we can have them vote. And so things like bird appear multiple times, things like wing appear multiple times, things like beak appear multiple times. And so we take those as the tags. So you can see here that we have birds and we have similar birds, and using all of those, we get a much better set of tags. I want to show you some more examples. This is, again, from the interface that Karen's going to present. This is a building. And you can see the related images. are, we calculated related images for every image, and so that's all on the website, so they load really quickly. And you can see that all these images, all these buildings kind of look alike, right? They have like a central tower, and they have like flanking sides that are a bit lower. Some of them are taken from different perspectives, but the CNN can still tell which are related. And then if you look at the tags, blue tags are what we added to Flickr. A lot of them don't relate, but a lot of them do. Theater, monument, London, fort, edifice, construct. And then birds also. So these birds are really interesting because they're not the same kind of bird. They're looking in different directions. Sometimes there are multiple birds, but you still get them as related images, which is really cool. And for the tags, you get bird, feather, tail, wing, black, brown, and some other things that don't make sense. So it's kind of a mix. But the idea is that you have a really good set of like good tags, and you have some set of like not so good tags. And so we're kind of working on how to get rid of the not so good tags, but keep the good tags. So, but as of now, we've put up 15 million tags on Flickr, about 15 tags for each image. And so the idea is like in the next step to kind of pare that back down. We'll see. So that's about it for tagging, and Luda's gonna talk next about captioning, which is really interesting.
All right, cool. So evolution, right? We have tagging, now we have captioning. But before I go into the technical details, I wanna just talk about why we wanna do this in the first place, right? So, you know, captions have been around for images for a long time. In a lot of the images, they do have captions by themselves. And we think that they provide opportunities for us to get more contextual information about where the objects in the image are related to each other. But I think more importantly, from just an AI research perspective, it is a really interesting task for a computer to be able to understand something about the image and be able to form coherent sentences about them. And I think we think it's a really hard challenge, and we're really happy to take a crack at it. So just very briefly, the background. It is a very active area of research in computer vision. The model that we base a lot of our work on was actually from a paper published around a year ago, incidentally by our professor at Stanford, which is great, because we can ask them. And it actually, on a very high level, what it does is it combines two distinct neural networks, the CNNs we talked about. There's also something called the recurrent neural networks, which are specialized to handle words because it keeps track of ordering. So what we do is we feed an image into the same framework, get a list of features that are representative of the image, and through a complex series of manipulations, get through to the string of words. So it's a very complex machinery, but what is sort of even more difficult than just the technical challenges was the fact that no one really done this before. So all the research that we saw was based off on high quality photographs. Microsoft released a lot of them. So they did that, they were able to get a lot of more details, less ambiguity in the images. Whereas the British Library image, obviously, most of them are black and white, they're lower resolution, and it can be hard to tell what's actually in there, right? So a lot of challenges there. But I think what's more difficult in our case was that with machine learning, one of the most important things is to find the source of knowledge, right? Without the source of knowledge, machines can't really inherently understand anything. So you really need a really good data set that tells you these are the images, these are captions, these are the right captions. And for this particular task, we didn't really have that. So what are we gonna do with that? So we decided to take the same approach as we did with tagging. We wanted to get the models that are already there. So we took a model that someone trained for these photographs, and we're like, hey, these are not perfect, but these do contain some information. Why don't we just apply them with a slightly modified version to our image and let's see what we get, right? So I'm gonna show you a series of results that we actually got. It's really interesting. Some of them are pretty funny. I hope you guys would enjoy that. Okay, so a couple buckets. I'm gonna divide the first bucket into things that worked well, around, I would say 5 to 10% worked really well. And so, this is the image, a man standing in a field with a cow, describes it pretty well. And again, keep in mind, these captions are generated without any human input, and we generated over 100,000 captions in around machine time, around 10 hours. So really efficient stuff. Similarly here, a boat, a photo of a boat in the water, pretty perfect. So that's what worked really well. We're really excited about that. Now we're going to move into things that kind of worked. They got some of the things right. Some of the things it got incorrectly or was just simply missing. For example, like this, a large building with a clock tower in the middle. Large building seems pretty solid, but the clock tower is noticeably missing. And this is actually a common problem that we found in these particular captions, that if there's a lot of, say, clock towers in the image set that it learned its information from, and not a lot in these images, it would try to hallucinate, quote unquote, these features. So we thought we had a lot of fun going through these. And then there's, this is pretty experimental. There's things that just didn't work at all, but I think it's still pretty interesting to look at that. So this is an image. Definitely is not a close-up of a bird on a tree branch. But we can still talk about this because what is really interesting here is that, you know, the neural net probably doesn't know what this animal is, right? I don't even know what this animal is, to be honest. But what it do know are birds and tree branches, right? And so it tries to match certain parts of this image. For example, the horn conceivably could have the same shape as tree branch. So, you know, it tries to look at that and it finds the closest thing is cease. And, you know, I think that's pretty interesting just by itself. Although sometimes it just, you know, this is a lady's mirror that it tagged as a streetlight. So I'll leave you guys to figure out how that happened there. But all these are available in the interface. You can browse through them. A subset of them have them. And so this is, again, just to recap, first time it's been done on illustration. Obviously, there's a ton of work that still needs to be done, but I think this is a promising prototype. Cool, so I'm gonna take a quick aside to talk a little bit about a data set we came across while we're doing this. So one of the things I talked about was that our training data set was substantially different from our illustration data set, which was part of the problem. And so through a lot of collaboration and talking with different people at the British labs, we stumbled upon the British Museum prints and drawings collections with over 200,000 images that are available just through the public interface. And many of them actually have good human annotated captions, right? And so we were playing around with the permission of the British Museum, where we played around with these a little bit. And, they had some mixed results. You know, there are some, for example, the middle is actually really good. We were able to get higher level details about which way the person is turning, which is quite amazing for a computer. But some other ones didn't really work so well. You know, U and K stands for, it just doesn't know what that is. So we got some results there. But what's really interesting is that, you know, this data set we think could also be used in a more, different task, for example, in tagging, where we can just chop off the captions, get the nouns, do the same, natural language processing, and the numbers are saying, how many images have that tag, and then really zoom in on, a bunch of different things that we can look at, bridges, ships, child, plates, something like that. So yeah, we think this is really promising. We'd love to hear what you guys think, anything further research that could be done. Cool, so I'm gonna turn it over to Karen to talk about the interface.
Sweet. So really briefly, all of the OCR and category tags are actually uploaded on Flickr right now, so you can go check that out. We also decided to showcase some of our other project features, including the related images and the captions with our own web interface, which is built on top of the Flickr API. So with that, let's explore SherlockNet. So this is the main page of the web interface. It shows a random selection of images from the Flickr Commons. I'm gonna try out some searches that I find interesting. So I really like dogs, see what happens. And this searches the SherlockNet namespace, so the tags that we generated for the project. So get a bunch of dogs, they're pretty cute. So what's interesting is that, for example, this image, we can click on it to get a closer look. It has dogs, it also has people, but it knows that these smaller objects are dogs. And we have a bunch of tags, if you guys could see that. Let's try to zoom in. So some of the tags that we generated include snow, northward. I'm picking the good ones right now, but I don't know about London. What's more interesting is that in the related images, imagine you wanted to find some cute pictures of dogs. This is a really good section to try to narrow your search because we have the neural network at work. It's finding these images that don't exactly match this composition, but it's clearly an image of a dog. So again, neural networks can sort of recognize images as we do, whether it's small or big, rotated, it still knows what a dog is fundamentally. Let's check out this image. It's also of a bunch of cute sled dogs. Let's check out the caption. So a dog is sitting on a beach next to a dog. We might caption it differently as humans, but we can think about what this neural network is thinking. And it's, two dogs are next to each other, and there's this plane that could be a beach. We know it's not because these people are dressed up in 10 layers. We can kind of get an idea of where this caption is coming from. And also in the tags, we have things that were taken from the context of OCR. So words like Eskimo sort of extrapolate is from the text. And we can click on a tag too. If you want to keep on searching, we get some pictures of Eskimos, and you can pretty much just go down an infinite rabbit hole. So we also have this fun feature. I think I was mentioned earlier that related words or variants on words is something that's really useful when you're using a tag-based search. So if I type in, for example, the word lady, and I think maybe there are other words to describe lady, but I can't come up with them off the top of my head. So I can suggest some synonyms, which include gentlewoman.
Look up there.
If I can... noblewoman, purist, really cool, way beyond my limited vocabulary. So it just does that for you, and it gets some ladies and some other things as well. So it's really fun. You can explore it. I'll give you the link right now. Let's do that. So you go back here, and you can explore at bit.ly/SherlockNet. Please check it out. Let us know what you think. I'm going to turn it over to Brian to talk more about.
Yeah. So far, we've talked about tagging and captioning and building a really nice web interface that ties all that together and gives a lot more information about the images. So with all that information, we were thinking, let's do some science on that. And let's, with our very limited art history knowledge, let's do some science on that with our perspective as computer scientists and biologists. But we wanted to look at how art changes over time and how does styles change over time? I think that's something that art history tries to go after, right? Renaissance art. How do art styles change between the beginning of the Renaissance period and the end of the Renaissance period, or anything else? There are infinite questions that you can answer. And the thing about styles is that they're really hard for people to pin down, but it might be easier for a machine to do it if it's looked at 100,000 examples. So we tried to do some prototyping to see whether our neural networks could do that. And we did this for maps and decorations. You can look at, so these are just individual examples of decorations and maps over time. And I think by eye, you can probably point out some differences between, say, a pre-1700 decoration and a post-1870 decoration. But let's have the computer try to do it and let's see what it does. So the way to do that, we thought, was let's tell the neural network to classify images into these different eras, and then let's probe the neural network to see what specifically it was thinking about. Let's look at, so what we did was we trained this on decorations, And we asked it which features, remember the features are neurons that like describe parts of an image, some abstract thing about an image. Feature 541 in particular was really high in modern decorations, but really low in older decorations. But then the question is, what is feature 541, right? And so there's the neural network doesn't give that to you, so you kind of have to find it on your own. But so we looked at images in our entire data set where feature 541 is high, and images where feature 541 is low, and let's use our human brains to try to figure that out. So on the top, you have images that have a high score for feature 541, and on the bottom, you have images that score really lowly for feature 541. And I think one thing that stands out, at least for us, was that these images have top and bottom panels. And so maybe feature 541 notices that these images have top and bottom lines, and that somehow indicates to the neural network that that's something that modern images are a little bit more likely to have. So we think that this is sort of a model of hypothesis generation. I think this is sort of similar to biology where you have a ton of data and you ask the computer to generate new insights and then you follow up on them. The idea is not for the computer to tell you what's true or not, but to be like, oh, this is interesting. Hey, you should follow up on this. And so we think that this sort of hypothesis generation might be a new way of approaching art history where you ask a computer to generate new insights and then you follow up on them with the insights that they've generated in order to produce new knowledge about art history. And I'll turn it over to Luda for the conclusion.
All right, thanks, Brian. Okay, so just to recap a little bit of what we did, we managed to generate tags for the entire British Library Flickr common set and generate captions, some of them very high quality for hundreds of thousands of them, while providing a really easy to use interface for the data set. And I think all of this is done, you know, in a very efficient manner. And we think, you know, this is something that could have a lot of value, right? So our, you know, ultimate hope for this project is to have it serve as a prototype for any aspiring digital collection to be able to find their content, make it more discoverable, find trends, find insights, and make it really efficient for people to discover, tag, cut down on manual labor, and finally, make the rich, rich set of materials that history left us more accessible. So that's what we think this could do. So definitely, we want to, there we go. There's been a huge amount of people. These are some of the people here that we want to thank, both at the British Library, Mahendra and the British Library Labs team, who really provided us with this opportunity. We want to thank them for everything they've done, and also at our mentors and collaborators at Stanford, and also the British Museum. This project's been a lot of fun. We worked through multiple time zones, and it was really challenging at times, but really, really happy to be here and talk to you guys today. Thank you, guys. Yeah, if you have any questions, just maybe start right there.
Thanks, that's a great presentation. I have just two questions which are quite discreet. I was really interested in your distinction between the picture where there was an Eskimo picture, which it picked up. But then I think the caption had something to do with a beach. And I think the tag included Eskimo. So I was curious about that, because does that suggest that the captioning is not cross-referencing the tagging? And the second question I wanted to ask about was the art history side, where the feature 541. And what I was wondering was to what extent you'd considered that's a framing or a remediation issue, so that what it's picking up is the image is not different, it's the original image is not different, the picture that's taken is framing the original image differently, so the two panels at the top and bottom are picked up in one set but not in another. So I would be interested in your comments about those two aspects.
Sure. So I can talk a little bit about the first question. So it's about how does the caption relate to the tags, if they're cross-correlated. Yeah, so the way that we did it was that the first part, so the CNN, used a common set of, you know, sort of pre-trained models. And we actually think, I think that we actually use a slightly different version of a pre-trained model, which might explain some of the discrepancies. But yeah, so the captions actually goes through a secondary process where it turns the image vector into words. And that's a really hard problem by itself. So sometimes a lot of the mappings don't map to exactly what it is. So I think that's the reason for that.
Yeah, so maybe using the OCR data in the captioning would help remedy some of that.
That's correct.
So that would be future research into that field.
Yeah, and for the second question, sorry.
Just keeping on time.
Oh, yeah.
I wonder maybe we could take one last question from...
is it okay if I answer that last question before, really quickly, want me to...
Is there another question? We'll get a mic to you while Brian is answering.
Sounds good. Thanks. So feature 541 was like top and bottom lines. I agree. We don't really know, right? And so that's sort of the downside of a neural network right now is that there's sort of no real way to understand exactly what a neural network is thinking about. And so you really have to combine it with a human annotation for now. But like in the future, I think there's a lot of research going on how to interpret a neural network. And so potentially it might understand, oh, maybe like this is just an artifact. It really could be an artifact.
Thank you. I've got my eye on the time, so I'll be very brief. Thank you for a great presentation, a wonderful project. I just wanted to ask you a question about, as your background is all in computer science and medical science, Melissa talked a little bit about getting folks at UCL from the computer science department working with us with humanities data. And the earlier presentation, clearly the researcher was from arts and humanities, but this is completely different from your background. So originally I was going to ask you what prompted you, but I think I picked up in your presentation that one of the professors from Stanford had been doing work similar to this, so you were sort of following on with that. So I'm going to readjust my question and ask you, with your relative backgrounds in computer science and medical research, how did you find working with images and what we would consider to be humanities type data and material via the British Library? Thank you.
Yeah. Sure. So I'm actually an art minor. So I wanted to, for this, we actually started this project as a computer science class project, and we wanted to find something that was relevant to the humanities, simply because we realized that there's not much overlap between, like, you know, computer science and furthering research in other fields. So that's kind of the reason, like, why we wanted to look for this specific humanities-related data set. I think we all found it really fun to work with it. We did a lot of just browsing through just manually. We found some really cool images, and that kind of spurred our decision to work in this project for the competition because we were like, wow, this is awesome. More people should know about it. More people should be able to search through it. And yeah, I think it was really fun to work with the British Library.
I think we actually found it on Wikipedia, so...
Yeah, thanks Wikipedia.
Thanks Wikipedia for that.
Yeah.
Okay. So thanks so much. Let's...
Okay, great. I think as they were working on it, we were really waiting with some anticipation to see whether the captioning techniques that had been developed for other types of images in another time would work at all or apply. And I think we've learned there's still more to do, but quite promising.